This is the house of bread.
The house of bread.
This is the house of bread.
Oh, yeah.
Where we're building leaders, changing the world. Welcome to Guiding Light Assembly.
Oh, yeah.
God has a word for you.
A word for
yes,
you.
There is a word for you.
Of his people, and when that word hits you, your spirit man becomes open for direction. In the name of Jesus, let the fire of the Holy Ghost come rain on you. So it was passed down from one generation to another. Everybody knew. Be healed. Be healed. In the name of Jesus.
Proverbs chapter 15, verse 22. Without counsel, purposes are disappointed, but in the multitude of counselors, they are established. I want to read that scripture for you from the Dore's translation of the Bible. Dore's translation of the Bible. So designs are brought to nothing where there is no counsel. Designs are brought to nothing where there is no counsel. But where there are many counselors, they are what? Established. Praise God. Strategies for accomplishing your purpose. Everything in life to be accomplished has a method to it. There is an approach. Now, I know we are born again Christians, and this is the problem. We do things anyhow. And the anyhow comes from our thinking that, not be God, you go do it for me. Praise God. When in Genesis, God created the heavens and the earth, first, he said the earth was without form and it was what? Void. In other words, here was an empty structure that requires systems. Someone says systems. And so when God began, creation was all about putting systems in place. Methods by which these systems will work had already been prepared. And so, you see, all that God created, he can recreate. And you, the fact that you see the all of creation continuing is because they are made to renew themselves. Praise God. So sometimes if you watch the sky, you will see the star run through and appear to have what? Extinguished itself. They say that's a falling star. Is that not what they say? Have you ever seen one star that fell down to the earth? Praise God. It just renewed itself. The sun is a system. The moon is a system. The stars are systems that have the capacity what to renew them. In other words, there is a method by which God makes them to stay perpetually on for as long as he wants them. They see how come it never ever runs dry. The earth continues. All these are systems God created. There is a method to everything. Someone said there's a method to everything. So you see, when life is lived without a method, it is lived in a jagajaga manner, as we would say in this country. And jagajaga lives don't produce. How many of us know that? To accomplish your purpose, therefore, you must find a method. Let us start by understanding what a strategy is. Then that's what I've just done. A strategy simply means a plan. Someone say plan. A method. Hello? What is a strategy? It means a plan. Someone say plan. A method by which you achieve an objective.
strategy,
series of maneuvers that you bring to bear to accomplish an assignment is what we call your strategy. Primarily, what we are doing is to get you to focus on the reason why God gave you life. How many of us know that? That's what this month is about. Try to focus your eyes, your mind, your energies, everything you carry towards accomplishing the purpose for which God keeps you alive and wakes you from sleep every morning. Our God is such an organized God. He is such a deliberate, purpose-driven God that everything he does deliberately with a view to achieving an end. So your life, as I said to you last week Sunday, that what it was a thought, the very thought of God. God came to a place where he said, I want to do this. To do this, it's going to be Margaret. To do this, it's going to be Jonathan. To do this, it's going to be Philip. It's going to be Charity. What will she require to do this? He put it in place. Everything you require to be who God wants you to be, to accomplish what God wants you to accomplish, is in you. Someone says it's in me. But the password is in the thing he wants you to do. When you run into that thing, click, it opens. Praise God. The password for your life is programmed into the thing God sent you here to do. And all the resources you require, the finances, the favors, the breakthroughs, the opportunities, the people that must help you are all programmed into you. Once you connect with that purpose, bam! And they are seizing. And you know, God is so frugal. How many of us know God is so frugal? He doesn't waste anything. In fact, he hates waste. So everything is timed according to the seasons of your life. So every season, the thing you require to do what he wants you to do, once you found it, pops up. Somebody will give it to you. Who must give it to you? I don't care what your situation is. I don't care what your limitations are. If you tap with a heart of gratitude into the power of thanksgiving, listen to me, that which has been a limitation in your life shall rise.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come. Longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you.
Everything in this world requires a method in order to get ahead. Many a great idea had collapsed for lack of adequate and appropriate strategy. Now I'm saying and prophesying over you that your dreams may never die for lack of strategy in the name of Jesus. First strategy I want to share with you is what we all know in our Bible. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, what did the Bible say? Now, apart from legitimizing your sonship of God, being Holy Spirit led in all things gives you the advantage of living a mistake-free life. Strategy number one, be open to be led by the Holy Spirit. Seek to be led by the Holy Spirit. Strive to be led by the Holy Spirit. Praise God.
Jeremiah says, it is not in a man that walketh to do what? Order his steps or direct his steps. For the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord.
Praise God.
Now, early in life, King David learned this strategy and stayed true to it most of his reign. One powerful strategy. You read the Bible, in fact, from 1 Samuel chapter 22, verse 10, to 2 Samuel chapter 21, verse 11, you will see 8 inquiries. And David inquired of the Lord. And David inquired of the Lord. And David what? Inquired of. And David what? Inquired. Every step he was to take. What was his method? Lord, how do I take this step?
Praise God.
The enemies came against him. He was a warrior. He knew how to fight. He didn't just jump into the fray. Lord, how do I attack these people? There was a time God told him, go straight ahead. And he dealt with them. And they said, no. The terrain was not good. And then at another time, the same people, during the same war, God said to him, Lord, how do I go this time? God said, go through behind the mulberry trees. Corner them. Strategy, method. So David was virtually invincible because he was always being led by God, by the Spirit of God. Being open and being led by the Spirit of God is a method that the wise old believers deployed that made them invincible.
Praise God.
Over and again, David deployed this strategy throughout his reign and gained tremendous advantage. Two particular situations came to my mind. Two instances where David, you know, particularly inquired of the Lord.
Praise God.
There was a time he was to move after the death of Saul. You remember? During the death of Saul, he was in Ziklag. Towards the end of Saul's reign, he settled in Ziklag, a city called Ziklag. How many of us remember? They went and burned down the city.
Praise God.
By the time they came, they had taken away his two wives. The entire city burned down, everyone taken captive. David was mad. In fact, his people were so distressed, they were willing to stone him. His boys, his men.
Praise God.
While they were busy ranting, David was inquiring of the Lord. He said, Lord, I'm so confused now. I'm so distressed. I don't know what to do. My family gone. What? My men. Hey, Lord, what do I do? He went to... Which way do I go? Did God answer him? Come on, someone talk to me now. God answered him and led him to the guy, one Egyptian that they left behind.
Praise the Lord.
That man was revived. He was at the point of death. He was revived and he led David and his men to the captors.
Praise God.
Should I pursue? Is that not it? Will I overtake?
What did God say to him?
Pursue and you shall overtake and do what? Recover all. That one thing he asked the Lord twice. Someone's a method. He never wanted to make mistake. Sometimes we hear ourselves and we jump. Hello? And so our mistakes are many. Our mistakes are what? Then, when he heard that Saul had died, he didn't just wake up and say, let me go back home. No. He went backward to deploy the same strategy. Lord, should I go back
to my country now? Which area should I go to? Where should I settle? God was specific. He said to him, go to Hebron. Settle there. Praise God. Because his time to be made a king had come. And if he got the strategy wrong and be at the wrong place at the right time, what God had ordained for him to happen will not happen. Because he's not at the place where it should do what happened. Many of us miss our time of visitation because we are at the wrong place at the right time. May that never be your portion anymore. In the name of Jesus. Strategy number two. Selflessness and generosity. Selflessness and what? Generosity. This strategy, beloved, creates loyalty and trust amongst those that God had given to you to assist you accomplish your purpose. No man is an island. You cannot do it alone. No matter how gifted, how anointed, how powerful, how resourceful you are, you need someone else to assist you. You need someone else to assist you. You can have all the monies in this world. You need someone to assist you. You need a driver. You need a clerk. You need a secretary. Praise God. You need a cleaner, a house help. Someone to help you. So you can get your job done. No man is an island. Now, if you want to accomplish your purpose in life, those that God has given to you, you must do what? Be selfless and generous towards them. Have you observed, even in real life, in ordinary life, that when your guy is selfish and not generous, you give him not high service or high service? Is that not so? And because you know that you have no portion in what he is doing. Is that not so? But when he is selfless and generous, you have a sense of belonging. Am I correct? You are willing to give your time, your best to make it happen for him. Is someone hear what I'm saying? Now, I know that in many of the textbooks, and I've read a lot of books, I have them, I read them, you won't find these things. These are Bible-based strategies that I had to bring out to encourage you so that with your head full of what the world has said about strategies to accomplishing purpose, you will use these ones to chalk them. Amen? And then you can go forward. You use their own, you use your own. Who is in front? You will be in front. Generosity, selflessness, and generosity. People don't want to have anything to do with us. They don't trust us. Hello? Listen to me. Until people know how much you care, they don't care how much you know. I didn't say that. Maxwell said so, and I agree with him. When people know that you care genuinely, you win their hearts. They will be there to assist you. They will be there for you when you need them. Genuinely, it's a strategy for winning in life. The third strategy I want to share with you as we wind down is tactical boldness. Someone say tactical boldness. Some of us have no tact. We are simply bold. And certain display of boldness can go for arrogance because people may not understand you. Do you understand what I'm saying? So you must be tactical. Apply tact. Normal everyday language to describe tact, be wise. Do it wisely. Hello? Be bold.
with wisdom. Amen. I'll give an example as I explain that strategy to you. Tactical boldness was the strategy David used to ascend to the throne of Israel. You all know that Samuel anointed him king, even though he didn't say, "I'm anointing you king." Is that not so? He never told him that, so he may not know. But eventually he came to know that this is what it's all about. Praise the Lord. He anointed him, but it took years. It took years from when he was anointed to when he sat on the throne. In all of this struggle, of course, David had run away from home because Saul had been looking for ways to kill him, knowing that he is the king after him. His desire, Saul's desire, was that Jonathan would take over from him. Praise God. You remember at that time where he was so angry at Jonathan, he spared him. Don't you know that this guy you are friends with is going to be king and you, everything is going to be lost on you? What's wrong with you? Be wise, son. No. But having run away from home, David lived away. Finally, he settled in Ziklag, and then the news came. Praise God. Some terrible fellows thinking they were doing David a favor. Praise God. Came to break the news to David that they were the ones that finished Saul. And they brought the crown with the paraphernalia of office to David. David said, "You are not afraid to touch the Lord's anointed." Hey, where are them? Those young boys, come. Fall upon them. And they finished them. Go read up the story. Very interesting story. It's loaded. Don't lie and try to be what you are not. Is someone hear what I'm saying? Don't lie and try. You will kill yourself for nothing. These boys were trying to be, they lied. They were not there. They were not there. They just saw the things. Hey, this carried it. Let's quickly go and curry favor. Let me tell you, some favors that we manufacture by ourselves are not favor. You saw what I'm saying? You don't have to work for the favor of God. That's why it is favor. Anything you work for is not favor. Favor comes by God's divine orchestration. It arrives on you, bam. You didn't deserve it, didn't earn it. It just happens. You know that's favor. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I'm Mr. Favor, so I can tell you this one. I live it daily. Is someone hearing what I'm saying? It's the mandate upon this house to walk in favor. Amen? With favor, you don't struggle. You don't go begging for. You don't haggle. You don't hassle. It comes on its own. These guys wanted the favor of the king. They went and lied to walk for it. Mm-mm. Many of us do that all the time. Let's help God. God does not need your help. Praise God. Doesn't need your help. So, they got themselves into trouble. And then, of course, David landed in Hebron. Let me tell you, that spoil that he brought, that his boys say, only those who went to the war, will, he said, God forbid. He didn't give it only to those who didn't go. He sent it to the elders of Judah. Is someone hear what I'm saying? He sent it to what? Hello. He sent it to his friends in Judah. Now, when he heard that, he has used that. That's part of generosity, selflessness and generosity. He has used that to do what? Prepare the ground. A man's gift does what? Not the bribe we give to close the eye. He wasn't bribing them for anything. He just sent them, "I love you, I care. There's something coming from me." So, when he heard that Saul was dead, having been made a king over Judah, he sent a word to
the immediate community of King Saul. I heard you are the ones that buried the king. God will bless you. Now, I have been made king of Judah. I too will treat you well because you have respect for, to whom respect is due. Praise God. Hear me, child of God. He had boldly declared, I have ascended the throne. But he did it with what? Wisdom. Boldly he was tactful. Second instance where he was to deploy this strategy, Absalom rebelled against him, drove him out of the king, the first coup d'etat. Hear me, child of God. Absalom died. When Absalom died, the word began to go around Israel. The king is our king. Should we not bring him back? Now that Absalom is dead, then some people began to say, no, he's not coming back. Maybe we should even think of giving it back to the house of Saul. Praise God. All of this came to his ears. David promptly had to exercise boldness, but tactfully. So he sent a word to his brethren of Judah. He said, you are my bones and my flesh. Why are you waiting to bring the king back? Some of us will say, well, let the will of the Lord be done. God has a method by which he achieves objectives. He sent the word around to the priests. Go round, tell the leaders, I should be brought back to my throne. And they went round. The bold step he took with a tactical approach disconcerted and discomfited those who had interest to create further confusion in his kingdom. And the king was brought back. God's purpose in the life of David was fulfilled. Hear me, child of God. Go read your Bible. Every king is measured by the standard of David. After him. All through scripture. Every king is measured by the standard of who? David. No wonder when he is coming back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, he will sit upon the throne of David to reign. Listen to me. When there is strategy, purposes are established. Without strategy, without counsel, purposes are disappointed. Have you got a strategy about your life? Do you know your purpose? Have you got a strategy to accomplish it? A man, a woman without strategy, even when they have discovered their purpose, will not be able to accomplish it. Let's rise.
I don't care what your situation is. I don't care what your limitations are. If you tap with the heart of gratitude into the power of thanksgiving, listen to me, that which has been a limitation in your life shall rise.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord.